Namaste, it's Renee, and welcome to my podcast, Peace, Love, Abundance. This is a place where I discuss multiple things. I wear many hats, and so this is an outlet for me to speak about different things, from yoga to Ayurveda. I'm a master herbalist, even a licensed esthetician. The skin is the largest organ of the body. And I feel pretty damn special knowing that I'm licensed to work with that. And it's pretty amazing how much the skin is indicative of internal health. Anyway, that's a little side tangent. But welcome to my podcast where I can discuss anything from, again, yoga to meditation to your skin, your health. I like to cover all of it because I believe in the full picture. I believe in putting the puzzle pieces together and creating the full picture. Because let's face it, a puzzle is nothing if you don't have all the pieces in place. It's not a picture. Today we're going to discuss the expectations within the yoga studio, the expectations of the yoga teacher, the students that come, even how the studio itself performs, right? The heating, the lighting, the music, putting it all together. But before I do, I'd really like to remind you how I am an independent podcaster and independent even business. I don't have any employees. It's just me. I don't even have somebody who edits these podcasts. So please even give me some, show some kindness and forgiveness if these podcasts aren't perfect. But you know, life is not perfect. My last episode, peace is not perfect. And owning your own business is not perfect either. As a matter of fact, I believe in being that true, raw, authentic person. And you know that when you're listening to my podcast, it's me. It's all me. From the recording, the subject, to the editing and getting it posted, it's all me. I would so appreciate a rating. A 5-star rating would be spectacular. Or even some feedback. If you have feedback, I am open to feedback. That is how I learn. That is how I grow. And I'm no stranger to it. So feedback is always good as well. But it's very easy to just even hit the little stars in iTunes, or rather in the podcast app on your iPhone. You just have to scroll to the bottom or hit the 3 dots. There's always those little ellipses, the 3 dots. And when you do so, you can say that you love it, like it, rate it 5 stars. I will not accept anything less than 5 stars. And yes, I'm being silly. Granted, 5 stars is the best. But if you give me less, again, I learn from feedback and I will accept it. But if you're also going to rate me less than 5 stars, definitely give me feedback so I know why you feel it was less than 5 stars. But as an independent and a small business owner, your support is very much appreciated. My website, if you'd like to check out my other services that I offer, is reneestahl.online. And I have yoga up there. It's called Yin Yoga Workshop, but it's all about the hips and doing yin yoga. Yin yoga is all the floor poses that helps you feel like you got a massage. After 20 minutes to an hour of doing yin yoga, you feel like you got a massage. So check out my yin workshop. It covers the acupuncture meridians as well as doing yoga poses seasonally to get into the different organs seasonally based on Chinese medicine and even Ayurveda. And it's amazing. It's only $10, but you can get so much out of it and so much new knowledge of your body and how it works and how you can give yourself some self-love through yin yoga. All right, on to our podcast. Expectations of the teacher, the student, the studio, and everything that goes along with it. Let's face it, we are human beings and we like to kind of premeditate things and have expectations in our minds of how something might go or how something might play out. If you've never been to yoga, it's 100% curiosity and the thought of creativity, maybe trying something new in your life that brings you to a yoga studio. And you might have some kind of expectations based on the pictures that you've seen, your friends post on Instagram or Facebook or on the news, if you've seen anything, advertisements. Even when you go to the doctor's office these days, they might have pamphlets on the benefits of yoga and a little brochure of some people doing a couple poses here and there. But even though it might be a vague expectation because you're not quite sure what to expect, there is some sort of expectation always there. But in the same note, ignorance is bliss. To try something for the first time, and it could be amazing. It could be awkward. But whatever it is, that's your experience the first time. You have nothing else to compare it to. And that actually is, to me, is kind of blissful. Any seasoned yogi out there, go back to the thought of your first day of yoga or your first week, month, whatever it was, if you can recall that first experience. Because one thing I want to cover here in this podcast is that once we become seasoned yogis, we become very much critics and we judge and we have these huge expectations placed on yoga instructors. Once you've taken a few classes, students, you start to have these huge expectations beyond what you had your first day of taking yoga. And these huge expectations weigh pretty heavy on the yoga instructor. I know this because I am a yoga instructor. And trust me, a good yoga instructor is always got your best interest in mind when they are guiding you through their practice. They might be newer to teaching and they might still have a few kinks they need to work out here and there. But guaranteed, you continue to support them and they continue to support you. And it becomes this amazing symbiotic relationship between the teacher and the instructor. So even coming back to how important feedback is, when I mentioned giving me feedback for my podcast, it's how I learn. It's how I grow. And even as a yoga instructor, we need actually constructive feedback. Now, negative feedback, things that the instructor can't control, like maybe someday the heat in the studio is broken. You like heated yoga and the heat or the humidifier is broken. You can't hold that against the yoga instructor. No way, no how. Even being pissed off at the yoga studio, you might be pissed at the moment because you were really hoping for that hot, sweaty class. But honestly, you know that things break. So let go, calm down. My last episode about peace was about finding peace amongst the muck, the mud, and the noise, and things being imperfect, and finding peace in that moment. Often, the universe has a way to deliver exactly what you needed that day. The only thing we can really control, we can't control everything in life, but what we can control is our reaction to it. And I firmly believe there's an initial reaction. There's always that initial reaction that if you don't practice, like Thumper from the Disney movie Bambi, if you don't practice saying nothing at all, if you can't say something nice, then that initial reaction can be harsh and sound horrible and be misread. But if you can, for a moment there, say nothing at all and just absorb it, take the class, get from it what you need and what you came for, and find the forgiveness in your heart and find peace in at least you're doing yoga. Because physically you're doing yoga, right? You haven't had your limbs amputated. It's just that the room doesn't have heat or humidity. So just slow down, take that deep breath, do the yoga class, and appreciate the fact that physically and even mentally you could be there in that moment, regardless of whether it was the perfect environment or not. Because we know that things break. So do not take your aggression out on the yoga studio or on the teacher especially, because the teacher really has no control over the heat and the humidity or the stereo if the stereo is broken. So finding compassion, that's what yoga is all about. And that's what drives me nuts. I get it myself. I became a yoga instructor, and whenever I learned the essentials on how to cue a good class and learning anatomy and alignment and even how to deliver that nice bell curve, how you start them out, you warm them up, and then at the top of the bell, things are intense and getting tough, and you're working your way through it. And then when the bell curve comes back down towards the end of class, once I learned the mechanics of a yoga class and even the style of vinyasa, I became a major critic. Because in every class I took after learning that, every class I took after that, I was judging how well did the yoga instructor do? How would I do it differently? What did they miss? What did they maybe go overboard on? We all do it. We all overthink things or carry our expectations too high. But in the end, be thankful and appreciate the fact that you have discovered this beautiful practice of yoga and it feeds your body and your mind and your soul. And finding distractions or noise or imperfection, it's a huge part of yoga, because if you can still find peace amongst all of that, then that's hashtag winning. You are winning. Even along with that, as a yoga instructor, for me to have a set plan of what I'm going to teach, to have everything written down perfectly, which, don't get me wrong, a well-planned yoga instructor is going to teach a well-planned class, especially in the beginning when they're newer. It is best that they plan things out. But what's going to take a good yoga instructor to great is being able to read the room. Being able to ditch a plan to cater to the students that arrived for that day. The ability to ditch a plan and teach accordingly to that room. Now, you might still teach 80% of your plan, but you're changing it 20% to make it fit that class. One day, I had only two people show up for yoga. Both of those people were fully capable of doing handstands, and they wanted the opportunity to do handstand as often as they wanted. So in that instance, I had to be flexible enough to make sure I gave them that opportunity to play with their handstands. Now, the opposite of that, I have taught yoga to two people before, and they were both beginners. They had no clue even what Warrior Two was, or even Tadasana. Once you learn what Tadasana is, you're like, oh yeah, standing up tall. But when you're new to yoga, you don't know the Sanskrit and you don't even know what Tadasana is. So when those two people showed up for my class and they were brand new and they were the only two people, I had to be prepared to take out any inversions that I had in my plan or any deeper postures that I had and be able to slow it down, explain things more and cater to them. So again, a good yoga instructor has a good plan and an idea of what they're teaching before they go in the room. But a great yoga instructor can cater to the room and who shows up that day. You, as the student, if you're a student and listening to this, you need to understand these variables and be very open to the thought that the instructor might be reading the room that day. And that might be why they backed off, or maybe they took it further. Don't be pissed off because they offered poses you can't do. They are teaching to the majority of the room. And within yoga, it's your responsibility to listen to your body and do what feels best for you. To the yoga instructors out there that might be listening to this podcast, if you are newer, or maybe you're not newer, but you are still sticking to a plan, you need to loosen up 20% and start catering to the class, reading the room and teaching what the room needs, and be okay with having to back off on your plan, regardless of what your plan is. So, right, there's this symbiotic relationship between the teacher and the student. The teacher, it's their classroom, it's their class. And as the student, you need to respect them and honor them. You can modify. You can do different variations of the pose they offer. Like in crescent lunge, if you want to drop your back knee and modify. If you want to skip the arm balance. If you want to skip the twists because you have something going on in your spine, that's fine. But in the end, respect your yoga instructor to know that that is their job. They're there for you, and they fully have your best interest involved. And they're trying to take you someplace, whether it's mentally, physically, or spiritually. They are trying to take you somewhere. And maybe the universe has brought you to them because there's a lesson in it for you to learn as well. So resist being too stubborn to not follow their guide, their lead. Maybe your lesson to learn that day is kindness, patience, compassion, and maybe even the gift of feedback afterwards if you feel they need some feedback for the class. But when you show up to the mat and 100% do your own thing and not pay attention to the instructor at all, you're sending a message that you don't need them. It messes up the dichotomy in the room. It messes up that symbiotic relationship. It's very distracting to the other students as well as the teacher. And it isn't doing you any good. If you know how to practice yoga on your own, do yoga on your own. Let's move on from here, though. I think I got that message delivered. But as a yoga instructor, also, it's not about creativity all the time. Yes, it's nice to have some fresh transitions or postures. Beating yourself up so much to be creative that you're burning yourself out and you don't know what to teach from one week to the next is tiring, and you will burn yourself out. So there's something to be said with a little bit of consistency. Keeping maybe 80% of your class similar to what it was last week, but changing 20% of it, all with the goal of taking your students someplace or somewhere. I love creativity. I really do. But I started to really realize that I would teach one arm balance one week and then a different arm balance the next week. And I never gave those students the opportunity to master that arm balance by doing it multiple weeks in a row. So in my almost 10 year, I've really learned that it's not my ego that should be driving the yoga classes. It shouldn't be my ego to think that each week I need to deliver something different. And also from the student's responsibility, you should keep your ego in check and not always choose a yoga instructor because they change it up every week. Yes, it might be good for the in your mind to have something different every time. Honestly, our bodies crave muscle memory and they crave being able to feel the progress in your body, to do a similar posture more than once and feel the progression in your body. However, everything in moderation, right? Don't get confused with my podcast on the hip openers when I talked about resist doing the same posture every class. I'm talking about in that episode doing the same posture, doing, say, half pigeon every time you do yoga. That's years and years and years of doing the same posture. Right now, I'm talking about doing the same posture for a few weeks to get deeper into other variations and then moving on to something else, even moving into something bigger and grander by building on to those postures and the creativity of a vinyasa flow. But within the creativity, we also need a little bit of predictability to be able to learn the postures correctly and be able to do them correctly and progressively feel your body evolve and change. Now, the flip side of that, again, coming back to being too creative, to where every week is something different. And I've been there. I've been that teacher where I felt like I needed to change it up every week. Sometimes I changed it up for my own mind because I got tired of hearing myself repeat myself. But that's kind of selfish of me, or that's my ego coming through that I feel I need to mix it up for myself. My best intentions are to deliver a class that my students can grow with, that they can progressively feel this change in their body. And it doesn't even have to be the most challenging class on the schedule. But if I have the results of their bodies in mind, then I can teach a very successful yoga class. I can't make everybody happy. But if each class has a heart opener, a twist, a forward fold, a hip opener, and some breath work, and with vinyasa, of course, you need movement with breath, I have done my job. And as a yoga student, you need to trust that I had your best interest in mind when I chose the poses that I chose for you. Is it possible to take a yoga class from somebody who maybe they're a little bit in their own head? As a yoga instructor, I have unfortunately met some people. They're young. Maybe they don't quite get it yet. I mean, young as in teaching. It can be a 60-year-old that just got certified. That's what I mean. Young in their teaching career. They may not quite get it, or they're all in their head because they're trying to remember so much from their teacher training that they're not quite connected with the students in the room. We need to have compassion for that because we've all been new at something at some point in our lives, and we know how hard it can be to connect those dots and keep it going. So have compassion for that person. But one of the best things you can also do is give them feedback after class. A lot of yoga studios have a way to give anonymous feedback even. But when you give that feedback, make sure it's coming from a place of love and compassion and with the teacher's best interest involved. You got to give them feedback that they can process and understand. Feedback telling them that they did the left side faster than when they went through the right side of the body is valid feedback. Maybe their music was too loud, too low, or the pace wasn't quite right. No yoga instructor can make everybody happy, but there are little constructive feedbacks you can share with your yoga instructor that they might be able to take into consideration, especially if they're newer. Let them know your experience. Speaking from your heart, you will be able to give some great feedback, especially seasoned yogis. However, do resist comparing one person to another. I once, believe it or not, got feedback one time saying, Renee is great and all, but she's not Jane Doe. Obviously, I'm not naming specific names, but to get feedback telling me that I'm great, but I'm not somebody else was not something I can work with. I can't change that. As a matter of fact, their feedback is absolutely right. I am not somebody else. But the fact that they took the time to write that down and make sure it got to me was more about their ego and their pride and their expectation, not even about me and what I could do to make the class different or better or as grow as a yoga instructor. So make sure your feedback comes from your heart. Even if maybe you have to wait a couple days before you get the feedback, you need to process it. Because you might even understand that while that instructor was different than who you're normally used to, they had a different message to deliver. So expectations. Expectations of the teacher expecting that the students can do everything they want them to do. Expectations of the student and how they want the yoga instructor to deliver the class. The room, the expectations of the heat, the humidity or the non-heat, the lighting, the music. There is a lot to the puzzle going on there. And having some forgiveness and peace of mind and knowing that the universe has delivered you something for a reason. And that yoga instructor, whether they're new or they've been teaching for a long time, they have your best interest involved. And the last thing they need is pressure of you expecting them to be somebody they're not. So be who you are and let them be who they are. And within that, let's symbiotically have this amazing practice together. The practice of teaching and the practice of practicing. And you have to honor all the pieces of the puzzle. And have compassion for the yoga instructor that may not be as creative as the other. Because what if they are understanding alignment more and giving you the cues you need? Creativity isn't everything. While it can mean a lot in a vinyasa style class, it's not everything. So as a yoga instructor, take a deep breath and relax. Don't beat yourself up about having to be 100% different from one week to the next because you will burn yourself out. and students have compassion for the yoga instructor that is doing their best to plan a class with your best interest involved. And isn't this the art of yoga? The art of forgiveness, non-judgment, letting go of the ego, or rather at least just cultivating the good ego and not the bad ego. Let's let yoga studios truly be that place where we escape from all the expectations and just enjoy ourselves, find relief, and breathe. Because in the end, I believe the breathing comes first. And you just need to show up and breathe and present on your mat. Presence is huge as well for the teacher and the student. Practice all of it in this symbiotic relationship that we all have together. Today, this is where I'll leave you. I'll leave you in this space of having compassion for where the yoga teacher comes from and everything we do to put together a class for you. Compassion for the student who may have had a bad day when they showed up to their practice, because everything within that hour can change. Let's let it change for the better. Let's find peace, love, abundance through the practice of yoga. And if you could, please rate my podcast. I'd very much appreciate it. Again, it's this symbiotic relationship between me and you. And without you, I'm nothing. And I appreciate you being here today. From the light in me to the light in each of you. Peace, love, abundance. Namaste.